Hallelujah. I want you to shout an hallelujah that God will hear from heaven. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, amen. Amen. Glory be to God. I want you to do something again. Amen. I want you to shout just one more hallelujah to show the devil he has lost the battle over you. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah, Father. Blessed be your holy name. Blessed be your holy name. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Then I want you to lift your voice to the Almighty God and say, Father, throughout this year, let me have cause to shout for joy. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. We are grateful, oh Lord. We are grateful, Lord. We are grateful, oh Lord. Hallelujah for all you have done for us. Hallelujah, we are grateful. We are grateful, Lord, we are grateful, oh Lord, hallelujah, we are grateful, oh Lord, hallelujah, for you have I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. The God of 2016 and the God of 2017. We bless your holy name. Thank you for all you did for us last year. Thank you in advance for what you'll do for us this year. Father, accept our thanks in Jesus' name. Father, we pray that throughout this year we will have cause to praise your name. Throughout this year, let us have cause to dance. Let us have cause to sing. Let us have cause to shout hallelujah. Thank you, my Father, my God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Well, let somebody shout hallelujah. Well, look for two or three people you have not seen this year and shake hands with them and say Happy New Year. As usual, we're going to start by addressing those who need to give their life to Jesus so that they won't miss their miracles in the part two. God made all things in twos. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, Genesis 1, 1 to 3, He made darkness and He made light. According to Psalm 30, verse 5, He made sorrow and He made joy. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So as we have night and morning, we have sorrow and joy. He made the wise and the fools. Just like He made glory and shame. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 35. Proverbs 3, 35. Say, the wise shall inherit glory, but shame shall be the promotion of fools. And we have the wise, and you have the fools. And one is heading for glory, the other is heading for shame. And whether we believe it or not, He categorized all human beings into two categories: children and dogs. Matthew 15, verse 21 to 28. Matthew 15, 21 to 28. He said, I cannot give the children's bread to dogs. We have children of God, we have dogs, and you're either of the two. Now, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, Matthew 5, verse 45, this Almighty God, this God that is so difficult to fully understand, allows the sun to shine on both the evil and the good. He allows the rain to fall on both the evil and the good. So the sun and the dogs. The sinners and the saints can cross into the new year, enjoying the same sun, the same rainfall. Why? Revelation chapter 4 verse 11. Revelation 4 verse 11 says God made all things for his pleasure. Everything he made, darkness, light, sorrow, joy, sinners, saints, children, dogs, he made everything for his pleasure. And then Proverbs 16 verse 4. Proverbs 16 verse 4 says, he even made the wicked for the day of evil. He created wicked people for a special purpose, for the day of evil, so that he will have people to use as examples to show why it is not right to do evil. He made the wicked for the day of evil, for the day of judgment, for the day of sorrow. He made all things in twos. And that's my Father. And nobody can query him. Nobody can say, why do you do it this way? The only thing is, as mighty as he is, as sovereign as he is, as unquestionable as he is, he leaves a door open so that the destiny of the wicked can be changed by the wicked. In Ezekiel 33, verse 14 to 16, Ezekiel 33, verse 14 to 16, he said, when I say to the wicked man, you are going to die, and the wicked man said, no, 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 I don't want to die, and he turns from his sin, and he begins to do the lawful things, and begins to do what is right, God said, I will look down from heaven and I will say, all right, I said you are going to die, but I changed my mind. You shall live. He said, if the wicked should change his ways, all the wicked things he had ever done will not be remembered. He said, I will just forget every evil that he had ever done. He said, because I have no pleasure in the death of a sinner. Ezekiel 33 verse 11. Ezekiel 33 verse 11. He said, I have no pleasure in the death of a sinner. All I want the sinner to do is repent and live. And that's why the Bible says in 1 John chapter 1 verse 7. 1 John chapter 1 verse 7. That the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses from all sins. All sins. So So the wicked who ends up in hell ends up in hell because he wants to. Because he has the opportunity to repent, to change his ways, and he refused to do so. When we get to heaven, there'll be many surprises. There'll be people you never thought would be in heaven who will be there. Why? Because they had an opportunity to change, and they changed. I tell you a story, and I give you the altar call. Some of you will remember this fellow. He was an Elijah. We met when I was in Ilorin. He heard the gospel and gave his life to Jesus. He was overwhelmed with joy, and we rejoiced with him. But after 3 days, he came back. He said, "Are you sure Jesus can forgive all sins?" We said, "Yes." He said, "Ha, you've not heard all that I've done. The evil I have done, there are so much, I don't think he can forgive all." We said, "Ah, have you given your life to him?" He said, "Yeah, oh, please go home rejoicing. He has forgiven all." He left rejoicing. 3 days later, he came back. He said, "You haven't heard all I did. I did this, I did this, I did this, I did that." We said, "Once you give your life to Jesus, he gives you a brand new beginning." He went home rejoicing. He kept going forth and backwards. Finally, he came one day. He said, "All right, I will tell you one more. If Jesus can forgive this one I'm about to tell you, I won't worry anymore." He said, "I wanted to make a charm. And to make that charm, I need the heart of a man." He said, "One of my relatives died, a young boy died. And they buried him. In the night, I went there, I exhumed his body, I tore the body open, and tore away the heart to use for the charm. Do you think that Jesus can forgive that?" So I opened my Bible to 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. Fortunately, you can read. I said, "Read that. The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses from all sins." I said, "What's the meaning of all?" He was quiet for a while. He said, "I think all means all." I said, "Correct. It doesn't matter how many sins you have committed up to this moment. If you give your life to Jesus, not only will you be saved, you will cease to be a dog and become a son. You cease to be somebody destined for the day of evil and become somebody destined for glory." So, if there's anyone here tonight, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to count from 1 to 12. Only 12. So those of you who are far away, you better begin to move. And those of you at the various viewing centers, this is a time to move towards the altar too. And if you are viewing in your home and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, this is time to stand up and let Jesus know you are standing up for salvation. There is a blood that can cleanse from all sins. That blood is still flowing now. So if you want to give your life to Jesus, before I count 12, come and stand before me and we'll pray for your salvation. And I'm counting now. 1. All right, thank you, counselors. Now we want to move on to section B. Romans chapter 8. We're reading from verse 14 to 17. Romans 8. 14 to 17. While you are opening your Bibles, let me encourage you that this year you will pray like you've never done before. Because those of you who are here, you how to compel your prophecies to come to pass. And those of you who are not here, I will encourage you, get that tape. When God has spoken concerning you, there are certain things you must do for the prophecies to manifest. One, of course, is to believe the God who sent the word. Two is to believe the prophet through whose mouth the prophecy had come. A man is called a prophet because he speaks forth the prophecies that has come from the mouth of God to him. Then one of the things you must do for your prophecies could come to pass is that you must fast. And then you must pray. And you must avoid distractions. I'm just trying to tell you some of them that I can remember of it. You need to fast. You need to pray. You need to focus on your God and ignore all others. Then what came to you as a sound will become a reality. I'm praying for every one of you here today. All the prophecies of God concerning you shall be speedily fulfilled in Jesus' name. Now, Romans 8. From verse 14 to 17. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit is bearing witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Abba, Father. What is the meaning of Abba? Everybody can call God Father. Because that's a general name for him. It's a general title. Even when the Lord Jesus Christ was teaching the disciples to pray, he said, this is how you should pray. Our Father, which art in heaven. a first fellow to utter in Mark chapter 14, verse 36. Mark 14, verse 36. He said, Abba, Father, all things are possible with you. The word Abba is a pet name for Father that can only be used by someone very close. In modern language, you want to say daddy. Or if you really want to get modern, you want to say popsy. There's somebody so close that you can call him something nobody else is calling him. When I started calling God daddy, in 1981, several people challenged me. They said I was being rude to God. I was being blasphemous. God is Father, not Daddy. I said, don't let us quarrel. He's your Father, but he's my Daddy. There's a difference between the two. How many of you feel that you are close enough to God to call him daddy? Then let me hear you say, Abba, Father. Everyone that is born again is a child of God. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3. He said, Beloved, behold, what manner of love God has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. So we have a Father, the Almighty. Now, if I have a daddy, I think I need to know him. Who is he? Because it's important to know who your daddy is. Knowing who your daddy is can make a lot of difference in your life. Daniel 11 verse 32. Daniel 11 verse 32 says, they that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Many of the things I have attempted in the name of my daddy is because I know who he is. Otherwise, it would have been madness to attempt any of them. Who is my daddy? Psalm 91 verse 1. Psalm 91 verse 1 calls him the Most High and calls him the Almighty. That's my daddy. Who is my daddy? Genesis 17 verse 1. Genesis 17 verse 1 calls him Jehovah El Shaddai, the God who is more than enough, the Almighty. Who is my dad? Exodus chapter 3 verses 13 and 14. Exodus 3, 13 and 14. He is the I am that I am. And I can go on and on talking about my dad. There's always a tendency for me to want to boast when I talk about my dad. But because of limited time, the next thing we ought to know about our dad is, what has he? Because the Bible says, I'm a hearer of God. He joined here with Christ. So I need to have a rough idea of what I can inherit. What has my dad? Psalm 24 verse 1. Psalm 24 verse 1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Everything that is inside the earth belongs to my daddy. Haggai chapter 2 verse 8, Haggai 2 verse 8, my dad said, silver is mine, gold is mine. So whatever money you have in your pocket is my dad who gave you. Psalm 50 verse 10, Psalm 50 verse 10 tells me that the cattle upon a thousand hills belong to my daddy. Psalm 62 verse 11, Psalm 62 verse 11 says, God has spoken once, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God, not to witches and wizards. Power belongs to my daddy. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12, 1 Chronicles 29 verse 12 says, both riches and honor come of thee. That's talking about my daddy. He said, thou ruler, thou reignest over all. He's the supreme ruler. He said, it in his hand is the power and might to make great. That's my daddy. So I know what he has. I know who he is. I know what he has. The next question, of course, is what can he do? My daddy can do practically anything. Practically anything. And I thank God for some of the testimonies we've already had, and we haven't had anything yet. That he could ask me to lay hands on some handkerchiefs, give it to the pastors to lay on the people, told the pastors to take the handkerchiefs home, and then far away from here, that handkerchief is raising the dead. That's my daddy. That's what he can do. That's what he can do. Anything. Luke 1:37. With God, nothing shall be impossible. Jeremiah 32 verse 27. Jeremiah 32 verse 27. He said, is the God of all flesh? Is anything too hard for him? That's my daddy. In Matthew 19 verse 26. Matthew 19 verse 26. He says, what is impossible with man is possible with God. Okay, what has my daddy done before? Because when somebody is applying for a job, they ask for his CV. They want to know his track record. And I can begin to tell you, oh, lots and lots of things that my daddy has done. Exodus 14, verse 21 to 28. Exodus 14, 21 to 28. He made a way where there was no way. In the Red Sea. Exodus 17 verse 6. Exodus 17 verse 6. He brought water out of the rock. My father can produce something out of nothing. Where you are seated now is an example of him producing something out of nothing. That's my daddy. I was telling someone not too long ago, when we came to this campground, it was the headquarters of highway robbers. Nobody wanted to live here near here at all. The only other thing that is common here were pythons, big snakes, 6 meters long. Big like palm trees. Nobody wanted this area. But my daddy said, this is where I have for you. He said, I'm going to build a city for you. We came here when an acre of land was being sold for 1,000 naira because nobody wanted it. And look at what my daddy has turned the place to now. He can produce something out of nothing. So I have good news for somebody here today. Right now, they may consider you as nothing. Before you die, the world will celebrate you. What has my father done? Throughout the Congress, we were looking at Ezekiel 37 from verse 1 to 10. Ezekiel 37 from verse 1 to 10. This same God we are talking about can make dry bones live again. After the Congress, Daddy began to show me several things that I didn't even see before in the same Ezekiel 37, verse 1 to 10. It was as if we should go back and look at the thing again. But he said, son, the one for the masses they've already received, the remainder is for you. In other words, he is saying to anyone who might be here today, don't you ever believe it when they tell you that your case is hopeless. Because there's no hopeless cases with my daddy. He can make dry bones live again. Now, this is where we now begin to get ready to pray. What can I expect? What can I expect as a son from my daddy? Because what I can expect from my daddy is determined by who he is, what he has, what he can do, what he's done before. What I can expect from my daddy is determined by those things I've already mentioned. Some children were playing in Elisha several years ago. One of them came to me and said, Daddy, I want a new pair of shoes for Christmas. I said, okay, what's the size of your leg, of your feet? We measured it. I said, you get your shoes in Christmas. He ran out and told all his colleagues, I have brand new shoes for Christmas. And one of them said, who told you that? Oh, Lagos Papa. And one of them also said, well, I also have new shoes for Christmas. And they asked him, who told you? He said, my dad, my father. Oh, they said, that is joking shoes. If it is Lagos Papa who said you have shoes, you have shoes. If it's your dad, he's just joking with you. I have a God who can never fail. When he speaks, it is done. How many of you believe that this year is going to be well with you? Let me hear you shout hallelujah. So what can I expect as a child from my dad? Number one, What can I expect from the one who is called the Most High? What can I expect from the one who, according to Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 8, Ecclesiastes 5 verse 8, is higher than the highest? I can expect promotion. Because according to 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 7 to 8, 1 Samuel 2, 7 to 8, Bible says, my father raises up one and pulls down another. He makes poor and makes rich. He makes low and he lifts up. They say, my father is so powerful, according to what is written, that he can pick up a beggar from the dunghill and make him sit among princes. That's my dad. So I can expect promotion from him. Not too long ago, there was a state occasion. Some 3 or 4 years ago. And all the great, great people were there. And by the time I was walking in, you know, in a place, in a situation like that, every chair is labeled. And they began to lead me forward. I was wondering, where are they taking me? Because I was looking in the direction of my colleagues. In fact, I can't call them my colleagues, my elder brothers, the bishops, the apostles. But they took me straight to go and sit at the same table with the head of state. And I remember the word. He can pick up a beggar from the dunghill and cause him to sit among princes. There is somebody here tonight. Before you die, you will sit with princes. From my father, who is higher than the highest, I can expect uncommon promotion. Daniel was a slave. But according to Daniel chapter 6 verse 1 to 3, Daniel 6 verse 1 to 3, he became one of the three topmost men in the nation. That's unusual promotion for a slave. I can expect rapid promotion, not just uncommon, but rapid. According to 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11 to 13, 1 Samuel 16, 11 to 13, the Bible says, one night David slept as a shepherd boy. By the following day, he was a king. That is rapid promotion. I want to decree to somebody here tonight, this year, your promotion shall be rapid. I can expect continuous promotion. Continuous. I've always told you, I think I've given the illustration before, how high I can lift this tambourine is determined by how tall I am. If I want it to go higher than where it is now, I think the camera should show us the tambourine. Okay, thank you. If I want it to go higher, I can go on my toes. But after some time, my toes will begin to pain me and I will go down on my feet. By then, the tambourine has come down lower. After some time, my hand will be paining me, and I bring it lower down still. When human beings promote you, they will bring you down. But when my daddy promotes you, because the Bible says his hands are everlasting arms, your promotion will be continuous. I can expect from my Father, the Most High, permanent, irreversible promotion. Oh, thank you, Father. The Lord said there is somebody here tonight. He said, since the beginning of the year, your cry to God has been, help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. He asked me to tell you, I will help you. Daddy asked me to tell someone. He said, this year, 2017, the garment of shame will be permanently removed from you. I said, I can expect permanent, irreversible promotion. Deuteronomy 28, verse 13. Deuteronomy 28, verse 13 says, you'll be above only and not beneath. You'll be head and not be tail. Permanent promotion. Thank you, Father. The Lord said there's someone here tonight who thought he has come because it is the first Holy Ghost service of the year. He said, let me tell you, you have come to have an encounter with me. So what can I expect from my Father, the Most High? Promotion. And there's no promotion like spiritual promotion, because that's the one that is most permanent. One day in America, we were coming down in a lift, and there was a young man there with us in the lift and several others. And the mommy wanted to speak to that young man. And he said, hey, pastor, this. All the other boys with us in the lift said, no, that mommy is not a pastor. He has just become a deacon. Now, I know some people, you must have heard from some people that said that if you want to become a pastor, join the redeemed, within 6 months you'll become a pastor. I always laugh. Let them come and find out. Those of you who are in, you know. You know how many years before you can become a deacon? You know how many years before you can move from a deacon to assistant pastor? You know how many years after you become assistant pastor before you become a pastor? So when mommy mistakenly called that young man pastor, all the others said, no. He has just become a deacon. And I heard God say to me loud and clear, ordain him a pastor. My commander-in-chief has spoken. The owner of the church has spoken. And when he speaks, there is no protocol. When he speaks, there are no rules and regulations. When he says, this is what I want, that is what will happen. Stand on your feet. Lift your voice to the Almighty God and say, Father, regardless of rules and regulations, promote me this year. Open your mouth and cry to the Almighty God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Please be seated. What can I expect from the one who is called the Almighty? I can expect victory without a fight. Why? Because my Father is the Lord of hosts. He controls all hosts in heaven, on earth, underneath the earth. Psalm 24, verse 7 to 10. Psalm 24, 7 to 10. Philippians 2, 9 to 11. Philippians 2, 9 to 11 says that the mention of his name, all knees bow. Daniel chapter 3, the true Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fiery furnace. What fight can you fight when they bind you and throw you into the fire anyway? But they landed in the fire, and the only thing that got burnt was the ropes that bound them. In the name that's above every other name, before Sunday morning, any yokes that may be left in your life will already be consumed. They threw Daniel into the den of lions, hungry lions. And the only people who got eaten by the lions were the enemies who threw in Daniel. As a matter of fact, by the time they brought up Daniel from the den of lions, it was promotion. I just have that deep feeling within me. I'm not saying, thus says the Lord now. This is me now talking from a conviction deep within me. That all those who have been standing in the way of your promotion, unless they repent, they shall become food for the lions. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 1 to 25, 2 Chronicles 20, verse 1 to 25, when God saw one young king that he was doing very well, that he was poor, he decided that the three richest kings in the neighborhood should combine their armies and come with their wealth to come and attack him. And when the little king heard about it, he said, oh God, I'm finished. Unless you help. And God said, don't worry yourself. You won't even have to fight. I will fight for you. And the wealth of sinners, we change hands. That will be the testimony of someone here today. By the time the enemies finish themselves, the Bible tells me for days, all the people belonging to this new king were carrying loads of money from the enemy. You know, I used to make a prophecy long ago. Probably the reason it hasn't come to pass yet is because nobody was bold enough to receive it. But now I believe your faith has grown. So I'm going to repeat it. That one day, when you take your money to the bank, they will close their door to other customers. Victory without a fight. I can give you several examples, but I think what we should do is just pray straight away. That you stand up on your feet and lift your voice to the Almighty God. And I beg you, pray with all your heart. And say, Father, this year in particular, fight my battles for me. Open your mouth and cry to the Almighty God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. So shall it be in Jesus' name. If you believe you are going to be victorious, shout a big hallelujah. You can please be seated. What can I expect from the one who is called the helper of the helpless? That's my dad. Because David said in Psalm 121, verse 1 to 2, Psalm 121, verse 1 to 2, he said, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I have a father. He's the helper of the helpless. The Bible calls him the ever-present help in time of trouble. Psalm 46 verse 1. Psalm 46 verse 1. So what can I expect from the helper of the helpless? Among other things, I can expect total security. What do you mean total security? You can try to protect yourself when you are awake. Can you protect yourself when you are asleep? Many a times we think we are secure because we have security guards. Security guards are human beings. They too fall asleep. Years ago, since I've changed now, but years ago, we finished a convention on Sunday. And then in the night, around 2 a.m., I decided to go around the camp praying, thanking God for the convention. I didn't see a single guard. As I was going around, I saw one sitting on a chair, fast asleep. I sat next to him. But when he was trying to drive away a mosquito, he nearly slapped me. So I got up quickly and left. I walked about another 2 kilometers and I saw another one. This one didn't even pretend. He arranged 4 chairs, removed his shoes, and lay flat. I wanted to take his shoes and torchlight away. But then I heard God say, "Son, you yourself, you should be sleeping now." So I left the fellow alone. But I thank God I have a father who neither sleeps, who neither slumbers. I can trust him for complete security. If he's your father, let me hear you shout hallelujah. In Psalm 121 verse 3. Psalm 121 verse 3. He said, "You won't stumble. You won't fall." In Psalm 121 verse 8. He said, "Whether you are going out or you are coming in, he will keep you." In Psalm 121 verses 6 and 7. Psalm 121 verses 6 and 7. He said, "You will have to worry nothing about danger, whether day or night." In Psalm 91, verse 5 to 10, Psalm 91, 5 to 10, he said, "You have nothing to fear, whether seeing danger or unseen ones." Total security from my daddy. Some of you will remember the testimony I gave you years ago when I was in Ilori. In those days, you can go from one end of Ilori to another in 15 minutes. No traffic jam at all. So I always went to the universities and then returned home for lunch and go back for my evening lectures. So I came home one day. After I finished my food, I looked at the time. I still have some time I could rest before I return to the university. But I didn't want to go and lie down on the bed so I don't fall asleep completely and forget myself. So I laid on the couch in the living room. And because I was also pastor there, members of the congregation from time to time, they come in and out of the house. So that they won't greet me, I close my eyes, pretending to be asleep. And all of a sudden, I was putting my two hands to support my head. All of a sudden, I felt somebody holding my two hands with one hand and my two legs with another hand. And I could feel that whatever it is about to kiss me. At first I thought, how could it be my wife? No, my wife won't do that in the open where people are coming and going. Number two, the fellow who can stretch one hand to hold my two hands by my head, my two legs down there, must be a huge fellow. So I opened my eyes and the thing disappeared. Ah, God, what is this? And I felt a very horrible coldness all over my body. Well, I brushed it aside. I got into my car, drove to the university, did my evening lectures. By the time I finished the lecture, by the time I got into my car, I was dying. By the miracle of God, I drove home. But I practically had to crawl out of my car to the toilet where I started vomiting and stooling. Almighty God, what's going on? I am your son. How can this happen to me? And I heard him say, I just want to give you a glimpse of the battles I fight for you without your knowing. Ah, thank you, Lord. And I became well immediately. I want you to stand on your feet. I want you to lift your voice to the Almighty God, loud and clear. I say, Daddy, please keep me secure forever. Go ahead, talk to the Almighty God. Keep me secure forever from enemies known and unknown, from enemies seen and unseen. Keep me secure forever. Keep me secure forever. Oh, there are enemies you don't know about. There are enemies that can pass through closed doors. But thank God for the one who keeps us, who will neither sleep nor slumber. He can keep you secure forever. Keep me secure forever. Keep me secure. Almighty God, keep me secure forever. I know that there are dangers everywhere. There are dangers from my father's house, dangers from my mother's house, dangers from husband's house, dangers from wife's house, danger in the place of work, danger everywhere. Father, just keep me secure forever. Keep me secure forever. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. So shall it be in Jesus' name. Please be seated. What can I expect from the one who is called the Great Counselor? Because according to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, the name of my Father is not just wonderful, but Counselor. I can expect from him divine guidance. Because as I go through this year and the other years ahead, from time to time I need to know what to do, where to go, where to turn, which door to knock at, etc., etc. Because according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 23, he said, while all things might be lawful, not all things are expedient. Proverbs 14, verse 12. Proverbs 14, verse 12 said, there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is the ways of death. So how do I go through the rest of my life without making mistakes? Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. Isaiah 30 verse 21 says, you will hear a word behind you saying, this is the way. This is where you should turn to the right. This is where to turn to the left. Because if he's guiding you, like in the passage that we read as text, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, the children of God, if he's guiding you, you won't fall into a trap. Those of us who grew up in the villages, we know how to catch rodents and rabbits. We set a trap and put a bait
The animal sees the bait and not the trap. And he sees the bait as God's provision. It is when the trap snaps shut that he realizes this is devil's provision. Anything that the enemy may want to use to lure you into a trap this year, the enemy will fail. In Acts 16, verse 6 to 10, Paul and Silas wanted to go to India. God said, no. And that seems to be the right thing to do. You say we should go to all the world. He said, I said so, but for you, that's not my plan. For you, it is good to be able to be guided by God. I was sitting in my office at Ebutemeta when a young man, prosperous looking young man, came in for prayers and counseling. By the time we finished, he was talking about the conference that was going to take place in America. I said, oh, who are the speakers? So and so. I said, oh my, it's going to be a wonderful conference. Suddenly he said, would you like to go? I said, yes, but I don't have the money. Oh, that's no problem. I will pay the money. I will buy the ticket. I will pay for your accommodation. I will pay for your feeding. I will even give you some pocket money. Lord, thank you. Open heavens. I collected information. I was glad. I pray for you, my brothers and sisters. The ability to know when the enemy is presenting you with poison, you receive it tonight in Jesus' name. He left my office and left. And I was saying, Lord, thank you. Oh my God, how good you are. And suddenly he spoke and said, sir, you are not going. Huh? I almost said, why? Because I know if he says you are not going, that settles it, I'm not going. I said, but this is something that will benefit me spiritually, that will help the work I'm doing. He said, you are not going. Okay, Lord. I waited a little bit for the man to get home, because in those days there were no mobile phones. And I picked the land phone and I phoned him. I'm sorry, sir. I won't be able to go on that trip. Why not? I'm sorry, sir. My daddy said no. He went. He came back 2 weeks later or so. It was news. Because this young man was working in the central bank. It had been discovered that he had been stealing a lot of government money. And they discovered a part of the money was what he even used for the journey he had just gone. Can you imagine me? Pastor Adeboye went to America, money stolen from Central Bank. Stand on your feet and cry to the Almighty God. Father, for the rest of my life, guide me every step of the way. Guide me, Lord, guide me.
Teach me when to say no. Teach me when to say yes. Teach me when to turn right. Teach me when to turn left. Guide me all the way. Guide me every step of the way. Guide me every step of the way. Please guide me every step of the way. Guide me every step of the way. Guide me every step of the way. Guide me, Almighty. Guide me every step of the way. Every step of the way. Guide me. For the rest of my life, let me know what to do so I don't fall into the trap of the enemy. Guide me every step of the way. Guide me. Guide me every step of the way. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. So shall it be. Please be seated. Thank you, Father. The Lord said, there's someone here tonight. He asked me to tell you to stop thinking of death. I have not finished with you yet. He said, there's someone here tonight. He said, by the time the first rain of the year falls, your harvest will begin. This is my own. The Lord said, there's someone here tonight. He said, whether you are coming or you are going out, you will always have something to rejoice about. Well, it looks as if it's about to conclude the rest of the evening with me. Because the Lord said, there's someone here tonight. He said, one of the surprises you are going to get is that you are going to live in divine health throughout this year. I like that. Amen, Lord. Daddy says there's someone here tonight. He said, those who have the ability to help you will be willing and they'll be eager this year. There are so many other things I can talk about, but I need to round up because of other meetings early in the morning. What do I expect from the one whose name is I Am That I Am? Because that's what he says his name is in Exodus chapter 3, verse 13. Exodus 3, verse 13. Amen. Daddy says there's someone here. He said, last year you were running, this year you will be flying. Oh, Lord.
want to say amen and amen to this one.
Daddy said there's someone here tonight. He said you'll be one of the first 100 to receive a mighty pleasant surprise. Okay. Now, so what do I expect from the one who is I am that I am? All I can expect is that wherever I go, he will be there with me. Because it's I am that I am. Not I was, not I will be, but I am. When you consider the story of Joseph, you will understand. When the boy was at home, God was with him. He was a favorite of his father. Genesis 37, verse 3. Genesis 37, verse 3. When he was in Potiphar's house, Genesis 39, verse 1 to 6. Genesis 39, verse 1 to 6. As a slave, God was with him. He was a slave, but he became managing director in the house of his slave master. When he was thrown into prison for an offense he didn't commit, Genesis 39, verse 20 to 23, Genesis 39, 20 to 23, the Lord was with him there. Because the jailer put everything in his charge. And like somebody said, if you are the one in charge in the prison, then prison life will not be as bad as with others. Because he was the one sharing the food, he was the one giving instructions. God was with him. And then, of course, he got a rapid promotion. From prisoner, he became president. You've heard the story before of the three fishes. For those of you who have never heard it before, I will tell it. There were these three small fishes in an ocean. And in the ocean, there were two sharks, mother shark, baby shark. Terrorizing every fish in the ocean, just eating every fish they can find. So these three fishes had a prayer meeting. They call on God to come down. Lord, come down, we want to talk. So the Lord came and said, yes, what do you want? The first fish said, what I want is that every part of my body will be eyes. Every scale become an eye. So I can see behind me, I can see to my right, see to my left. Before the shark can come near me, I would have seen the fellow. And so I'd be able to escape. The Lord said, are you sure that's what you want? You said, yes. That's okay. You got it. Second fish said, I want wings. Two pair of wings so I can fly. So if these sharks will come after me, I just fly out of the water and they can't fly. The Lord said, that's what you want? He said, yes. Okay, you got it. And then he turned to the third fish. And what do you want? That one said, all I want is that wherever I go, you go with me. The Lord said, okay. So the Lord left. Immediately he left. The bird, the fish who wanted eyes, had eyes all over the body. The one who wanted pairs of wings, two strong wings. Not long after that, the sharks began to hunt. And the first fish they saw was the one with many eyes. Oh, what a beautiful fish. And they began to swim towards it.
And he swam rapidly to the beach. And he could see a little pool of water away from the ocean on the beach. Because of so many eyes, he could see. So he made one big jump and landed in that little pool of water and began to laugh at the sharks. Come and get me if you can. And then soon, the sun rose, the little pool of water dried, and the fish with many eyes died. When the sharks found that the one with many eyes had escaped, they turned around to look for another one, and they found the one with two wings. And as I began to pursue that one, it flew out of the ocean and began to laugh. You can fly, come and get me if you can. But at that moment, an eagle was flying overhead. I looked down and said, what am I seeing? This is a fish. Oh Lord, how good you are. I have always wanted to eat fish, but I can't swim. Now you have brought one to me in my domain. And so the bird with two wings ended up in the stomach of the eagle. And then the baby shark said to the mother shark, hey, there's a third one here. It's not even afraid of us. Just swimming about as if we don't exist. Let's go and get it. And the mother said to the little shark, are you blind? Can't you see that wherever this fish goes, the shadow of a man is following him? You go near that fish, the man whose shadow you see will kill you. The Bible says the Lord is your shade on your right hand. Stand on your feet and cry to the Almighty God. I say, Father, everywhere I go this year, just go with me. Open your mouth and pray. Everywhere I go, please go with me. Go with me, Lord. Everywhere I go, go with me. This year, everywhere I turn to, be there. If I turn to the left, be there with me. If I turn to the right, be there with me. Anywhere you are not going to follow me to, don't let me go there. Father, please, abide with me every step of the way this year. Abide with me. Everywhere I go, please go with me. Please go with me. Please go with me. Please go with me. Everywhere I go this year, go with me, O Lord. Go with me. Everywhere I go, please go with me. Thank you, Father. Go with me, Lord. Go with me, my Father, my God. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. So shall it be in Jesus' name. Please be seated. Now comes the question. What does my Father expect from me? We've been talking about what I expect from my daddy. What does my Father expect from me? If I'm a good son, if I'm a true son. Like the man who took the offering said in Malachi chapter 1 verse 6. Malachi chapter 1 verse 6. God said, a son honoreth his father. If I am your father, where is my honor? God expects you to honor him. He does not expect a son to disgrace him. No father will expect disgrace from his son. When a son did something to his father not too long ago somewhere, and we said, your son did so, so, and so, he said, no, 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 not my son. So, 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 and so by name, I said, ah, that's a bastard. You will never be called a bastard. Because God said in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 30, 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 30, he who honors me, I will honor. He who disgraces me, I will disgrace. That's a mother language. He expects you to honor him. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 to 10. Proverbs 3, verse 9 to 10. That's why the Bible says, honor the Lord with your first fruit. It's a honor to him. Not that he's in need. Honor your dad. A father does not expect you to rob him. No good son will steal his father's money. The few places when God got so angry that he pronounced a curse on those who are supposed to be his children, it's in Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 to 11. Malachi 3, 8 to 11. That's why he said, why are you robbing me? Why are you robbing me? Then he said, okay, if you choose to rob me, then I curse you. God expects you as a son, as a daughter, not to rob him of his tithes and offering. God expects you to boast about him. Psalm 119 verse 46. Psalm 119 verse 46. David said, I wish witness about you without shame. Without shame. I will tell everybody who my father is, what he can do, what he has done, and I will do it without shame. When you say the reason you cannot witness to sinners is because you are ashamed,
You are telling God you are ashamed of him. That's dangerous. That is dangerous. God expects you to be actively involved in the family business. He expects you to be building his kingdom along with him. He expects you to be laborers together with God. Zechariah chapter 1, verse 17. Zechariah 1, 17. He said, through your prosperity, my city shall yet be built. He expects you as a son to be involved in the building of his kingdom. God expects you as a true child of God to make your father happy. Luke 15 verse 10. Like I told some of you during the Go Fishing program, every time a soul is saved, Jesus gets up and dances before the angels. Every time a soul is saved, he dances. The Bible says there's rejoicing before the angels. Who is the one rejoicing? The Savior. Another sinner has come home. My effort is not in vain. My blood is working again. Every time you win a sinner to Christ, Jesus gets up and dances. He expects you to make your father happy. And of course, I'm sure you know this is most likely where I will be ending for now. He expects you to be holy. Why? Like father, like son. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15 and 16. 1 Peter 1, 15 and 16. As he who has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of your conversation. For it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Don't disgrace your father. Don't steal from him. Honor him. Be partakers of the family business, which is soul winning, building churches, establishing parishes. That's God's family business. And be holy, for he is holy. Because this is the first Holy Ghost service in the year, I'm going to give you about 10 minutes to come before Abba Father and ask him for mighty things for 2017. And may I assure you of one thing? My God is more than sufficient to meet all your needs. Anything you can ask for, his name is Jehovah El Shaddai, the God who is more than enough. So the altar is open. I'll give you 10 minutes. If you want to come to the altar, you can come and come and talk to God. And say, this year, Abba Father, you are my daddy. this is what I want you to do for me. I want you to show yourself mighty on my behalf. I want you to fight my battles for me. I want you to accelerate my promotion. I want you to give me the grace to do your will, to please you. Abba, Father, this year, do for me what you have never done before. Let's go ahead and talk to the Lord. Because he's the helper of the helpless. Wherever your help may be hanging, he will bring it speedily. All those who should help you, who are withholding the help, until they release it, they won't be able to rest. Wherever you go this year, my daddy will go with you. You will not fall into the trap. Every plan of the enemy concerning you shall fail. It shall be well with you. The grace to please him, the grace to win souls, the grace to establish churches, receive it right now in Jesus' name. In all your actions this year, God shall be glorified. God shall be honored. And he will honor you in return. It shall be well with you, and your joy shall be full. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Well, let somebody shout hallelujah.